We open with some words by the American pagan writer, Starhawk. We are all longing to go home, to some place we've never ever been, a place half remembered and half envisioned. We can only catch glimpses of it from time to time. Community. Somewhere there are people to whom we can speak with passion, without having the words catch in our throats. Somewhere a circle of hands will open to receive us, eyes will light up as we enter, voices will celebrate with us whenever we come into our own power. Community means strength. A strength that joins our strength to do the work that needs to be done. Arms to hold us when we falter. A circle of healing. A circle of friends. Some place where we can be free. We light our chalice flame, as chalice flames are lit in our brother and sister congregations across the world. And as we do so, we will hear words from Steve Stock. We light this chalice to celebrate the inherent worth and dignity of every person, to reaffirm the historic pledge of liberal religion, to seek that justice which transcends mere legality and moves towards the resolution of true equality, and to share that love which is ultimately beyond even our cherished reason, that love which unites us. Welcome. Welcome to our meeting house today. We gather this autumn day to form community. We gather for many reasons, for comfort or for challenge, to find nourishment or a space to share. We gather for acceptance, and we gather for care. Now, yesterday, the 20th of November, is a day recognised the world over as the Transgender Day of Remembrance. The transgender flag, flown here, you'll have seen it in the earlier clips and you'll see it later on, is flown with both pride and with sadness, as the day calls for the remembrance of all those transgender individuals who've been killed, most likely for simply being who they truly are, over the last year. Now, in the last 12 months, the 12 months to October this year, 375 transgender persons were killed. Killed for being themselves. It's shocking. It's sickening. And they will be remembered. But it asks a bigger question. It asks a bigger question about inclusiveness, about exclusiveness. It asks a bigger question around acceptance, around needs, around our role as a spiritual community. We reflect today on attitudes to others, to acceptance, to welcome, to support, to love. How we as Unitarians may stand as allies to those in need, whoever they might be. This time and this space are yours. I bid you a very warm welcome. Our first hymn today is a call to welcome, with words by Peter Galbraith. We stress, all are welcome here. The words will be on your screens. Our first reading is adapted from a piece by Susan Gilchrist, a member of the Corrymeela community, Ireland's oldest peace and reconciliation centre. This is drawn from words Susan shared as a liturgy created for the Transgender Day of Remembrance. Great harm is done when people use the most insulting sexual slur they can find and then apply it to transgender people. Not only is the insult itself destructive, it is being applied to people who are trying to live lives which are true to who they are. According to some groups, a person's sex, male or female, is an immutable biological reality, which is unambiguously identifiable at birth. It is alleged by these groups that there is no rational or compassionate reason to affirm a distorted psychological self-concept that one's gender identity is different from one's biological sex. That viewpoint is reinforced by the traditional teachings which condemn homosexuality and, by implication, gender variant behaviour as intrinsically disordered. This does not match the experience of transgender people who find their gender identity contradicts their biological sex. Many have fought against this unremitting sense of gender identity for many years. There is the same range of moral attitudes and behaviour amongst transgender people as there is in society at large. There is also as great a range of sexual orientations amongst transgender people as that which exists in wider society. Thus, the primary concern for transgender people is about their identity. It's not about any sexual act. These condemnations did not help David, a human rights lawyer with an outstanding international representation who, as Sonia, became intimately involved with her Anglican parish church when she was killed by being pushed off the platform in front of an underground train in King's Cross. Today, these condemnations do not help Angela, who is becoming suicidal, not because of the attitude of her fellow workers, who she describes as brilliant, but because of the difficulties her senior management created. They do not help those who have fought their inner sense of gender identity for years, the trauma of which has now brought them to collapse. They do not help the person living beside you, living an ordinary, unremarkable, and respectable life in the role to which they truly belong, who may have come on the gender journey transsexuals make. In the Christian tradition, and more widely, there have been terrible acts of discrimination and murder towards those perceived as different. However, for St. Paul, there was no male and female, and nothing in all creation that could separate anyone from the love of God. For Jesus, the love of God reigned beyond all gender and was totally supreme. Tragically, this teaching is not reflected in today's society. Many transgender people report harassment, mistreatment, discrimination in their jobs. The rejection by family, the refusal to use the appropriate gender pronoun, and the insistence on continuing to address someone by the name they used before transition are attacks that are commonly found. The scapegoating which occurs when societies and religious organisations condemn all transgender people for misdemeanours creates great misunderstanding and distress. Many sources report that 41% of transsexuals have attempted suicide at least once in their lives. The lack of understanding which brands transgender people as gender benders, pretenders, fraudsters, perverts, is the source from which the greatest discrimination occurs. Our society should be one in which this ignorance and misunderstanding applies, and a society in which the gospel of love is fully expressed. The need for transgender people is to live the same lives to the same moral standards as everyone else in ways that are true to their own identities. Words adapted from those of Susan Gilchrist from the Corrymeela community. Let us come together in a time of prayer. We are products and partakers of the divine, whether we like it or not, as are all things that live, all things that exist. With our minds, we explore the mystery that is divine, seeking light in darkness and darkness in light. As our souls seek communion with each other in love and fellowship, so they seek and find the divine. We cannot see the divine face to face, yet we encounter the divine all the time and everywhere. If we have eyes to see and ears to hear, senses to connect with what is around us, and spirits to reflect. The divine is the great mystery, and we can never really know. And yet the divine is no mystery at all. May we have the clarity and the humility to realize it. Let us pray today for all who suffer. For those suffering physical pain through injury, illness, disability. For those in mental anguish through grief or fear or shame. For those who are bereaved or bereft. For refugees and for the homeless or dispossessed. For all who have been wronged, hurt, or disappointed. For all who suffer discrimination and harassment. For those who live their lives in fear. For those who face the chaos, the hurt and the horror of war, for families and communities torn apart by violence. May all who suffer find the solace of laughter and of love, the strength to bear and the release of rest. May we be inspired this day to live in mutual understanding and trust and peace. We are brothers and sisters, all belonging to one great human family, joined in one spirit of love. May we learn to live as comrades in willing fellowship and loving fraternity. In brotherly and sisterly helpfulness and cooperation. If you wish to, please join with me in the words of our final prayer. which will be on your screens. Eternal Spirit, we meet together that our lives may be transformed. May our misdeeds be washed from us, and may we be cleansed of our wayward deeds and thoughts. In our hearts, we are not perfect. We have let ourselves down. We seek to make amends. May we have truth in our inner souls, and may we recognize the joys of living lives in love. May we seek the presence of the divine to restore us. Heal us, O Spirit. Make us anew. Amen. Our second reading is from the book Radical Hospitality by Daniel Holman and Lonni Collins Pratt. The book is about a new approach to welcome and asks its readers hard questions about how we truly understand welcome and inclusion. Catherine had never felt accepted. You know the kind of kid. You went to school with a few of them. It was as if she had been selected the very first day of kindergarten to be always on the outside. Maybe she was wearing mismatched mittens one day, or she still had peanut butter on her breath from breakfast. Maybe she wore the same shoes her sister wore last year. Father Dan never knew the reason for her being a social outcast. By the time he met her on retreat, she was firmly in place as the target for the teenage sport of ridicule. Without knowing the details, you can be sure that Catherine spent a lot of very tough nights growing up. She must have wondered if her life meant anything, and wondered if anyone would ever listen to her. She probably did not dare hope she would ever be loved. It's hard to imagine, if you've never been on the outside, what it can do to you. Just getting out of bed each morning becomes an act of courage. On one of the worst nights of her life, Catherine called Mary Cummings, Father Dan's partner in retreat ministry for almost 30 years. She called Mary because once, when Catherine had dropped her books and whatever else she was carrying, Mary stopped and helped. Mary extended the simplest of courtesies to this girl that had only known contempt. By taking a moment to look into her eyes, say a few words, and help in an awkward situation, Mary demonstrated to Catherine that she could be counted on to care. On the night when Catherine honestly did not know if she wanted to see another sunrise, she called Mary. When we speak of hospitality, we're always addressing issues of inclusion and exclusion. Each of us makes choices about who will and will not be included in our lives. To make such choices is inevitable. We do not have time to be everyone's best friend. The reasons we include and exclude are very personal. You and I probably can't say why we become close to some people and have no interest in getting to know or include others. Issues of inclusion and exclusion, while personal, are not just personal. Our entire culture excludes many people. If you're in a wheelchair, for example, you're excluded because there are places you can't go. If you're very young, if you're very old, you are excluded. In high school, you can be excluded if you don't wear the right shoes or listen to the right music. Women are excluded, as are people of color, and those who practice a religion different from our own. Hospitality has an inescapable moral dimension to it. It is not a mere social grace, it's a spiritual and ethical issue. It's an issue involving what it means to be human. Hospitality puts an end to injustice. Hospitality is both the answer to modern alienation and injustice, and a path to a deeper spirituality. Words from Radical Hospitality by Daniel Homan and Lonni Collins Pratt. Our second hymn is based on traditional words that talk of the importance of love in a community. Let love continue long. The words will be on your screens. The Unitarian Universalist minister, the Reverend Jonipher Kwong, currently minister to the First Unitarian Church of Honolulu, wrote recently on the three jewels that guide his belief. The three jewels are, he says, we take refuge in all that is holy. We take refuge in sacred teachings throughout the ages. We take refuge in our community of faith and in the interdependent web of life. It might be considered a good start for many of us to explain a little of why we come here on a Sunday, or similarly why we search out the YouTube videos at certain times. Perhaps on a Sunday, perhaps a different part of your week, but an equally valid routine. We're taking refuge. We're finding a way to satisfy a deeper call or perhaps a need within us. But what is this need? Now, some of you may be aware of a structure created by Abraham Maslow in the 1940s, known as the hierarchy of needs. Maslow's hierarchy is most often displayed as a pyramid. The lowest levels of the pyramid are made up of the most basic needs, while the more complex needs are at the top of the pyramid. And as each level, you start at the base, and as each level is met, you are able to progress to the next. And ultimately, these are what we need for a fulfilled life. Needs at the bottom of the pyramid are basic physical requirements, including the need for food, water, sleep, warmth. And once these lower levels have been met, people can move on to the next level, which for Maslow was safety and security. And as people progress up the pyramid, needs become increasingly psychological and social, and soon the need for love, for friendship, for intimacy becomes important. And further up the pyramid, the need for personal esteem, feelings of accomplishment take priority. Now, Abraham Maslow emphasized the importance of self-actualization, which is a process of growing and developing as a person in order to achieve potential. Now, what I find quite fascinating about Maslow's hierarchy of needs is the way in which different parts of society, different groups, different communities can help people to meet their needs. However, most intriguing is the role that a religious community might be able to support an individual as they progress through several, if not all, of those needs that Abraham Maslow identifies. Now, starting with the psychological needs, whilst most of us are probably fortunate enough to have or afford our basic psychological needs, we do too help provide for those in need. So through charity fundraising, in the days when we had lunches, it might come back, when we raised money for various charities, homeless charities, for support charities for refugees and elsewhere. Contributions to the food bank that we gather here weekly. And other basic support structures. It may not be much in the grand scheme of things, but I trust that we never begrudge the chance to give from our own to help those in greater need. Now, physiological needs are, of course, and in Maslow's case, literally, the very least we can meet for others. And then it's safety. Now, safety can be quite a difficult concept. Do people feel safe in this meeting house? Do people feel safe in our communities? Or is there a sense of uncertainty, of unease? Now, I suspect basic physical safety is generally a guarantee. We are unlikely to flood. There are no bare wires, well, not many. And we live in a country where physical attacks are, thankfully, a very rare occurrence. Not everyone has it quite so easy. However, for someone who is less confident, uncertain, taking first steps in realizing their true selves, how do we ensure everybody feels truly safe? Which aligns and moves towards the next level, which is towards love and belonging. And this is where, perhaps, we can really start our work. Now, Unitarians do have a strong claim to be a group that does welcome all. Perhaps. In our ministry, for example, we've trained and supported women ministers since the early 1900s, and in 1977, we passed a resolution declaring our ministry is open to all, regardless of gender, sexual orientation, or race. Over 40 years ago, a strong statement, even now in many church groups, and something we can be genuinely proud of. And we are a movement that is based, it's Unitarian, it is based on the idea of being believed in the oneness of God or of the universe or of the all that is. Now we are each of us different, and as Unitarians we recognise the benefits of a diverse world, the world of difference, the possibilities that might come from a world of difference. And I cannot, no matter how hard I try, change the prejudices of the world overnight and the laws of foreign or even in this country. But that doesn't stop me being responsible for doing all I can to put things right, to change my actions, to change opinion, to make the world more fair. I can try and remind others that there are real people, real flesh and blood people out there, real emotions under strain. If we are to offer a true welcome, not just to people like us, a true welcome, well, that's sometimes a bit harder. Now, the truths contained in our first reading, that piece from Susan Gilchrist of the Corrimila community, the stories of terrible injustice, of prejudice, of sad and tragic murder and suicide. To be transgender in this world can be a very dangerous place. Yet it is not a choice. To be transgender is to recognise your own truth, to be able to safely declare who you are requires a safe and welcoming and truly inclusive community. Now, it's of course our reactions to the world and its events that define who we are. Who we are as individuals and who we are as people of faith. Many consider that we're all part of this great world. I certainly do. We're one with its hopes, its majesty, its awesomeness. And we're one with its problems, its tragedies, its great and small. And we are one with everything, with the all that is. There are a great interdependent web of life to which we belong. And we owe it the courtesy of treating all its parts with love and light and understanding. Now, to return to Jonipher Kwong's points, the three jewels that we heard earlier. What are the three jewels of a religious community? We take refuge in all that is holy. We take refuge in sacred teachings throughout the ages. We take refuge in our community of faith and in the interdependent web of life. And this is perhaps where we need to take a very good look at ourselves. Jonipher raises a deeper issue when he uses the word we. We take refuge. To what is he referring when he makes that point? What do we hear when, as individuals, we consider ourselves part of a collective? We. Now, around 10 years ago, Daniel Holman and Lonni Collins Pratt wrote a book about radical hospitality. Our second reading today was taken from it. And the book was written to present a radical vision for a kinder world. Based on the approach adopted by Benedictine monks, and Daniel Holman is a Benedictine himself, the hospitality they strive for is not cosy and comforting, but risky and world-rattling. It is not, as the blurb puts it so beautifully, about sipping tea and making bland talk with people who live next door or who work with you. It's about a mutual reverence, a call to revere what is sacred in every person ever born. Now, the extract we heard earlier gave a brief introduction to the importance of inclusion in a world of exclusion and of misunderstanding. Yet this is not so easy as we sometimes like to think. Radical hospitality, the active and deliberate act of welcoming and including all, is a tough discipline and sometimes goes counter to our ingrained and often unconscious bias and prejudice. At the heart, however, is the need to recognise the humanity of all. We are all human beings, and we all require the same hierarchy of needs to make our lives complete. As a community, perhaps as a radical community, we must surely reflect on how we understand the we of Jonipher Kwong's three jewels. Is ours a passive inclusivity, a passive hospitality, or are we able to take more purposeful steps than that? Now, James Martineau, the great Victorian Unitarian theologian, developed a concept that all, that everyone, is an incarnation of God. Just as in Christianity, Jesus was heralded as the Son of God, Martineau saw divinity in every human soul, not just one. And this was a substantial rejection of that tradition that held that humanity and God are hopelessly estranged from one another. Martineau considered that God is present in us through our conscience. Now, he did believe in a father figure God. No matter how you reconcile the great divine mystery within your own theology, the message Martineau sends is a compelling one. If God is present within each of us, if the same divine spark is present within each and every single person, then we're all connected. And any slight against another human being is a slight against the divine and a slight against ourselves. To overlook, to ignore, to depersonalize, to condemn is to hurt ourselves. Those three jewels, holding us to account each time. We take refuge in all that is holy. That's everyone. We take refuge in sacred teachings throughout the ages. We take refuge in our community of faith and in the interdependent web of life. Now, as many reflect around this time on the tragic loss of so many transgender people through violence, a violence stirred by misunderstanding, by exclusion, by difference, might we as individuals and as a congregation reflect on how we might take steps to ensure that we are truly inclusive? Might we be allies to all those who are marginalized by society, all those who are abused, all those who are killed for failing to conform simply to binary norms? Might we reflect on how we can offer radical hospitality to all in need, to all who feel excluded, ostracized, dehumanized? I shall close this with the third reading. It's a piece by the Reverend Yopi Boki, my first Unitarian minister, now retired gracefully. And this is a piece from a book of readings and prayers from contributors across the Unitarian movement. But this is a piece that Yopi wrote called Sometimes. Sometimes we are so filled with ourselves that we only see ourselves. and not the person opposite us. May we enlarge our souls and make room for others. Sometimes we no longer have hope for each other or for ourselves or for the future. Sometimes we ignore each other, speak only words of pain and separation. May we be given new words, words of peace, words which create community, words which bring healing and blessing and belief in the future. May we open our doors and invite others in, feeling safe in spite of our vulnerability. May we learn to live with each other and for each other. Let us come together now in a time of stillness and reflection. As we settle our bodies, perhaps closing our eyes, I shall speak some words and I shall strike the singing bowl, and we shall come together in stillness and quiet. That stillness will be broken by music to continue our reflections. As we settle our bodies, I speak those words once more from the Reverend Jonipher Kwong, the three jewels. We take refuge in all that is holy. We take refuge in sacred teachings throughout the ages. We take refuge in our community of faith and in the interdependent web of life. Some closing words. Today from the Canadian actor and producer, Elliot Page. Elliot, formerly Ellen Page, took the brave step to come out as a trans man in December last year. And in March this year, was the first trans man to appear on the cover of Time magazine. He says this. This world would be a whole lot better if we just made an effort to be less horrible to one another. If we took just 5 minutes to recognize each other's beauty instead of attacking each other for our differences. That's not hard. It's really an easier and a better way to live. May the peace and love we bring to this gathering remain amongst us always.